I say to you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after he has killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear him. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 copper coins? And not one of them is forgotten before God. But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. Also I say to you, whoever confesses me before men, him the Son of Man will confess before the angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. And anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But to him who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven. Now, when they bring you to the synagogues and magistrates and authorities, do not worry about how you should answer or what you should say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. My name's Arthur, and I thank you for joining me as we share together these words of Jesus, directed to his disciples in consequence of the attacks that he was experiencing from the Pharisees and the lawyers. He was warning them to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, that is, hypocrisy, that they were not to be seeking their own reputation or honour, but they were to be true and faithful to God, not to be intimidated by those who would threaten them. Now, the Pharisees and the lawyers represented the authorities of the society. And so Jesus, being under attack from them, put him at risk. He'd already, in fact, told his disciples that they would end up crucifying him. So the challenge is, they will intimidate, they will threaten, they will criticize. And Jesus says, do not fear those whose authority is simply that they can execute you. They can kill you, maybe legally or maybe illegally, but in this context, it is that they are using the political system against Jesus, and they will use it against the disciples. In other words, governments will outlaw followers of Jesus. And that has happened throughout history. For most of the first 300 years of the Christian period, to worship Jesus and not Caesar was a crime punishable by execution, and many were executed. And so Jesus is warning his disciples that they're going to be brought before governors and councils. They will be judged at a community levels within synagogues, that is, within assemblies of local people, and before governments at a national level. And he says, do not fear. These people have authority and they may kill the body, but the one that you are to fear is always to fear God, because God's judgment will be to cast into hell, into the lake of fire. After the body has been killed, God will grant us a new body. But there are 2 resurrections, the resurrection of the just and the resurrection of the unjust, Jesus explains. The just will enter into the kingdom prepared for them by their Father, and the unjust will be cast into the lake of fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Your individual circumstances are known by God. Are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 copper coins, and not one of them is forgotten before God? You see a dead bird in the bush? The Lord knows all about that bird, where it's been. He's provided for it, and now he has taken its life. We do not place much value on this bird. It's just part of the world that God has created. But God knows about the bird, and God knows about you. Concerning you, he says, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. The genetic profile of each of us is, in fact, the detailed way in which the hairs of our head are numbered. Before this present era, we could not imagine how this could be so. When you demolish a building in one place to erect it somewhere else, then you will number all the pieces and mark out how the pieces are reassembled so that you can have some chance of rebuilding the building in a new place. This is the point of the very hairs of your head are numbered. Though the body might be killed, yet the plan to which you were constructed will not be thrown away, but you will be reconstructed with a new body, a resurrection body. And that resurrection body won't be marred by the things that might have marred your natural body now, for it will be restored to original order. That's the whole point of resurrection. So we are not to fear death, because after death, for the believer, comes resurrection. The issue is whether we will be confessed before the Father or not. And so he declares, whoever confesses me before men, him the Son of Man will confess before the angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. When the Lord comes, he will send his angels to gather the elect from every part of the earth. So the angels will be given the names of the righteous, that they are to gather together. There will not be any mistakes. There will be none left behind that should be collected. Nobody who will be collected who should not be. And the basis is that the Son of Man will prepare the list. He will confess our names before the angels of God. But if we deny him, he says he will deny us before the angels of God. The process then is quite straightforward. In other passages, or in the earlier chapter, he said, don't rejoice that demons are subject to you. Rejoice that your names are written in heaven. God has maintained a record of your life, and he knows whether you have confessed him before men. And in this context, it is the good confession, the confession under threat, the acknowledgement of Jesus when the pressure is on and the cost may be your life. So that if we give our life for Jesus' sake, then we will receive it again. The issue always is the Lord Jesus. It's not the goodness of our lives, for we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. When the light is shone onto our lives, then we will all have something that we are ashamed of. The question is whether those things have been forgiven, because Jesus has taken the penalty for them all, but we may not have accepted his atonement on our behalf. So the price has been paid, but we must confess the Lord Jesus. That's what Paul says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's not a matter of who our friends are on earth or which church we attend or don't attend. It is what we have done with Jesus. But of course, what we've done with Jesus will affect the rest of our lives. So anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven. The point is that while we have life, we can change our mind about the Son of God, and it is the Holy Spirit of God who will prompt us to do so. But he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven. When God draws us by his Spirit to himself, that Spirit of holiness, and we do not yield, then our sins will not be forgiven. There is no other salvation under heaven given amongst men whereby we must be saved. But in the name of Jesus is preached to you the forgiveness of sin. The Holy Spirit then has that role of drawing us to God. But when we come to God, he comes to indwell the believer and make us holy in our lives. That is when the authorities will oppose us for righteousness' sake. When they bring you to the synagogues and magistrates and authorities, don't worry about how you should answer or what you should say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. In other words, when God's Spirit is in you and God puts you in a situation, then God is with you and his Spirit will be with you, and you should say what the Spirit puts in your heart. So this is Jesus' challenge. Do not be hypocrites like the Pharisees. Do not fear men who can kill the body, but fear God, who will raise every body, some to eternal life and some to eternal damnation. Not on works of righteousness that we have done, but by his mercy he has saved us.